Hello there, international movie fans. We got something very special for you in this video, because today we're gonna have an interview with Alan Davorje. Alan Davorje is the director of Red Dot, the first Swedish Netflix globally released movie. We're gonna talk with him about the movie and about how he came up with this quite wild story, what went into the script, but also the making process, the shooting, how this movie was made, who are his inspirations while making this movie, all those kind of things we're gonna dig into. Before we get into that, don't forget to subscribe to our channel if you're not subscribed yet and want to stay updated on the latest movies and series from the Nordics, but also other parts of Europe and outside of Europe and the US. So don't forget to hit that subscribe button, like this video if you liked it. Then we will now get into the interview with Alan Davorje.
Hallå!
Älskling, den är på dig. Flytta.
Sluta!
Welcome, Alan Davorje. Do I pronounce it well? Because of course I know a bit Swedish by now, but I know it's not Alan Darborg then, but...
No, people in Sweden can't say my name, but I say Alain Darborg. It's like
Alain Davorje.
Sounds good.
You can say Alain Dabou. I sound like a French director, you know.
That could also be interesting if you want to go with that.
Alain Delon, Alain Dabou.
It sounds nice.
Welcome. Good to have you on the show. We are honored. We all watched the movie Red Dot this weekend. Yeah. Quite a thrill ride, if I may say. How has the last week been for you? Because it premiered last week. I think you must have gotten a lot of messages since then.
Yeah, I've gotten a lot of messages. This film is making people uneasy all over the world. So I get a lot of love, but I get a lot of hate too from people who love dogs. They really hate me.
Well, you got a guy
beneath you.
That's no problem.
You know, I love dogs. I really love dogs. So I'm not a dog hater. And the dog is safe and sound right now. So. You know,
I never thought it was going to be something else. That's good thing.
Somebody had to die, actually. Too bad it wasn't done, but somebody needed to go.
I was doing a bit of research to your career, Alain, and of course watching this movie. But what I found, like, where does your fascination with fruit come from? You know what I'm referring to?
Yeah, I know. You know, that started my career, those fruit films. You know, the fruit films are 7-second clips on YouTube with people getting fruits in their head. That's it, you know. And I don't know. It was just a silly thing. I did with my friends a silly thing with somebody asking for an apple, and then his friend threw an apple in his head. And we put it on YouTube, and then, like, 1 year later, it had like million streams, and I was, holy shit, God. What's happening? And then, like, right now it's like 7 million. All those fruit films had like 7 million views.
Nice. I envied you a bit. Like, we have these super long videos, and we stick maybe at 100, 200 views, and I see this 8-second clip, and like, then you think, like, okay, that's a filmmaker.
You were your time really beyond. Now we have TikTok and Snapchat, but you were already making 8-second videos back in history, right?
Yeah, back I started the whole YouTube. There was actually people in school, like kids, were throwing fruits at each other. So teachers called me and said, "You got to take away these clips because it's getting crazy."
Nice.
That's good.
So you made kind of a jump from throwing fruit to this movie. I don't know if Boss already wants to go to this topic.
That's a good one. But what I mostly also really saw on your channel, like, I also saw this little clip of a man on an escalator who got off the escalator and he was wearing no pants. That one. So I felt also, after seeing the movie Red Dot, like, subverting expectations seems to be a recurring theme in your work. Is that right? Yeah.
I need to I like to push things. I like to take chances, either they work or not work. But I like to be on the edge. You know, that's where I like to be when I'm doing stuff. And also, I started doing comedies when I was, you know, I started doing films when I was 15 or something. But I'm always done things that upsets people or they love it. You know, I'm always been at the edge somehow.
Yeah. Yeah, that's so you're that's a common thing for you. You're used to that kind of thing, because if you look now a bit at reviews, you also see that mixed bag, like people that really love it and people yeah. that are like, I don't get it.
You know, love and hate is like, it's the same feeling. It's on the same coin. If somebody loves yeah. it, somebody needs to hate it too. So
exactly. Exactly. Yeah.
So the films I love are also hated. So it's yeah. Yeah.
It would be interesting to get into that also a bit, bit later. But so when you start working on something like Red Dot, which also subverts expectations when it comes to genre, but also the story, you have nowhere in your mind like how's the audience gonna react to that? This.
You know, when I'm writing, I wrote this with my friend Per Dixon, and when we were writing, if we came to a point and like, holy shit, what's happening now? Then we had something good on our mind. If we went uncomfortable writing it, then we knew that the audience would have the same feeling watching it. So that's the way we wrote it. We tried to like make each other uncomfortable all the time when writing it. I was like writing a scene with the dog, and I sent it to him, and he's like, "Holy shit, man, you're sick!" I'm like,
is that just coming through your normal inspiration moments, or do you take some well, traveling or experiences to create space for inspiration like this?
You know, I don't know, but the thing with the Red Dot, that's been haunting me since the 90s, because in the 90s in Sweden, there was a guy called Lars Ermanen. You know about that maybe, Bas.
No, I have to ask my girlfriend. She's the Swedish.
yeah, okay. Yeah, Lars Ermanen, he was shooting immigrants with a gun.
Oh, I heard about it.
And there was a laser. He had a laser sight. So it's from the 90s. And I was so afraid of, you know, that red little dot. And I remember growing up, there was like, skinheads were popular in the 90s here in Sweden. Yeah. And at my school, they were like having these laser pointers and like pointing at us, you know. I have dark hair, so they used to point at me and stuff, you know. I've always had the chills with that small red dot.
That's where it comes from. Okay.
Yeah, it's come from there. But it was when I was hiking with my previous girlfriend like 5-6 years ago, and we sat in a camp high up the mountains. There was no people there, and I just thought, holy shit, what if a red dot were up here right now?
Yeah.
And I got the chills, and that's the tenth scene. So that tenth scene is the first scene I had in my head. And then, you know, I had that in my head, and I started thinking of other action beats. And then there was like 6 months later, I was unemployed. I was miserable. I was like, what the fuck am I going to do with my life? And then I met another unemployed bastard, Pat Dixon, my friend. And I told him, like, we should do a movie, just me and you, because I have this idea. It's only two actors. How hard could it be? So we wrote the script and we tried to make it ourselves, but it was so fucking hard. So we couldn't do it. It wasn't as easy as we thought. So, but then the script got to SF, and then from SF to Netflix, and wow, now it's out there.
What was so hard about it then? What was the hard part that you stumbled upon each time when you were writing it?
Yeah, it's like financing these type of films. It's
okay,
hard.
Like that, yeah.
Yeah. And also, you know, on paper, it's two people on a mountain. How hard can that be? But it's super hard to shoot at the mountain, actually.
So when did you finish the first script then? So years ago?
2016. Okay. We finished the first version,
To take one step back, you started with this red dot. That was the beginning point. You knew you wanted to have a red dot as the antagonist. Did you already what was the next step? Was the next step who's holding the gun with this red dot? Yeah, exactly.
Exactly. Yeah. We were writing it, and you know, it was fun when we wrote this, because the story developed itself. We were just writing, and holy shit, they hit a child. Shit, what the fuck? Oh, it's the neighbor. Yeah. So it's just unfolded in front of us. It was pretty fun.
Yeah, it sounds like fun. How did those sessions go? You just get together, have a beer, and you just, how did that go?
We sat from 9 in the morning to 6 in the evening and just wrote.
Not great.
And I think we wrote the first draft in, it took like 3 months or something. But then we've rewritten it almost 100 times. So
And was the whole story when the first script was done? Was the whole story like it is now, or did there came some changes in between the production was starting?
No, the story is quite similar. Of course, we've done some changes, you know, because of production and where we shoot and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But the story is the story in the film is the story we wrote from the beginning.
And what was the motivation for you to do it like this? Was there some personal experience or something else that you wanted to put in?
No, it was the chill from the red dot, to be honest.
Yeah.
I had the tenth scene was my first scene. It was like, holy shit, this is like so... I got the chills when I thought about it, you know? So that was what was the motor all the time. I knew this scene is going to be great. Nadia and David aren't good people, you know? But, you know, it's they're not bad people either. We wanted to, like, understand them. It's like everybody in the film is great. They're people, yeah, exactly. Yeah. And you read about these things all the time. People hit somebody and drive away. And like, who are those people? Are they like evil? Because they have to be evil. But, you know, so that was pretty interesting.
Yeah, and the way you were telling it was also kind of, I was misled a bit, of course, because you start finding them sympathetic in the beginning and you, because they're the main characters and you, well, you can kind of identify with them. They seem to have a normal life. Was it on purpose to trick the audience with that and to make kind of a statement, maybe?
Yes, it was. We actually, because you've seen this type of movies before, like Deliverance or Eden Lake, you know? So we're playing with the genre to fool people, actually. Not to fool people, but... We when we wrote it, we put the scene where the... Because you remember from the beginning, it's like a yellow frame for 2-3 seconds before we cut to 1.5 years later. When we wrote the script, we put the car accident there. Because the yellow frame is symbolizing the yellow jacket of
The boy, of course.
So we put it there to see when we write the rest of the story, they're arguing and everything. So it, you know, it's holds in place. So if you watch the film carefully... we thought maybe people have to watch this film like 2-3 times because there's hidden stuff everywhere about the
hidden clues.
Hidden clues. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. But was it always supposed to be because you tell it partially in a non-chronological way? Was that always the plan, or was it also at some point maybe your plan, like, okay, let's just do it chronologically? They hit the kids, they have to flee for their lives more or less.
No, it was always a plan. Our first script was exactly like this, actually.
Yeah, okay, good, good.
So it was a plan from the beginning. And through the film also, I've read a lot of comments, they're like, oh, they make so stupid decisions here and there. But, you know, that's the whole point of the film. These people make stupid decisions, and of course.
I also felt it like that, but if you say it like this, it makes even more sense then. Yeah.
Well, that's the whole thing.
But can you explain why you want to portray them like people who make stupid decisions?
I don't want to portray them like making stupid decisions, but you know the whole thing is about, you know, the whole film. In the end, Nadia, okay, this time I'm gonna make the right decision. I'm not gonna run anymore. I'm gonna run back, but it's too late. It's her death now. You know, she should have done the right decision a long time ago. Whatever that is. So, and so. You know, it's the film is about decisions and taking your responsibility. Yeah. And of course, throughout the action, they make mistakes. But it's, you know, I would have done the same thing in panic. You know, I would have died.
Yeah.
The first minute the red dot appears, I would have died right away from a heart attack or something. these aren't heroes. These aren't heroes. That's the point.
That's one of the things I really, really loved about this movie. That it's not a movie about heroes. And that's maybe why I also really loved it, because I could relate to it. I read also some comments that say, like, that man, he's such a whoosh and he's not standing up. And I feel like, I wouldn't be this brave hero. And so I felt like, I can relate to this instead of relating to James Bond, which is totally not me. So that was good. Koen? You had a question?
We're talking about this, like they're making stupid decisions. So it was really meant for them to, the moment they meet the other brother and they go into the cave of the hole, I think, with the wolves.
Yeah, with a bear.
And they shoot the flare at him.
Yeah.
You really wanted them to not take the snow scooter. That was your intent also.
Yeah, that was an intent. Do not take the snow scooter. Just run away from here.
I was really thinking, my God, take the snow scooter.
We had a dialogue, but I cut it out. But there was they were afraid to go back to the snow scooter because maybe the other guy was there. Uh-huh. You know, there's two shooters also there. So they're panicking. They just, we have to get away from here.
Is that maybe also a bit again the subverting expectations thing that I can see in all your other things also? I don't want to take the easy route that everybody expects, but do the opposite, so to say.
Yes. I like when a turning point in a film is so bad that when you're writing, you don't know. Okay, I don't know how to get out of here. You know, I don't know how to solve this. It can't be solved. You know, if we have that, then the audience will, you know, have no idea where the story is going. Because sometimes you write and you're safe and okay, this can happen, but you write with the expectations of what should happen, you know?
Yeah.
And then the film gets predictable. It's boring. I don't like those types of film that much.
So in talking in that sense that you don't like those kind of films, who of the two of you came up with the scene where he had to do with the drilling machine?
I'm sorry, that's me.
What was the inspiration for this? Was it from another horror movie or?
No, because you know my girlfriend was pregnant at that time, mm-hmm. and the most I just thought, what's the most horrific thing I can think about right now? And the first scene actually, because she was more pregnant in the first version of the script. It wasn't a drill, it was a hammer. David was have a hammer and he was supposed to hit. Yeah, it's more. But then we realized, okay, she can't hike when she's that pregnant. So we can't have, she can't be full pregnant. So we change it to a drill.
But you really felt like seeing your wife or girlfriend pregnant, you really thought, what is the worst that can happen to my loved one? And that's how
I put myself in an uncomfortable place because I think, the audience will feel uncomfortable watching it then. So it's answering your question, Sven. We take inspiration from real life. So all the characters, scenes, not everything, of course, but it's inspired by people we met, stuff we've been through and, fears we have ourselves and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Yep.
Exactly.
And you say it's also about decisions and actually not taking them. Eh?
Yeah.
There's kind of a message, I think, from you. But is there some point in that you want to? Because in the end, it goes really bad with the main characters. They're dying, and you as a viewer, you're left really like, oh my god, it's really it's a tough ending, and it's like the. Tooth from a tooth, eye from an eye, or the opposite around. But why did you choose to end it like that? To punish?
Yeah, it's a punishment, of course.
Yeah.
And I see this film as, short, maybe Stephen King novels, or in Sweden we have an horror writer called John Ajvide Lindqvist. I don't know if you read his... He wrote the Let the Right One In. You've probably seen the film. Yeah, and he also writes short novels, and I love them, but they're all about some sort of punishment for people behaving wrong.
Yeah. Well, that's
so much pleasure out of it now talking about it.
Yeah.
And the thing, this is something if the bigger question is don't just think about yourself,
Yeah.
Because people are
egoists.
People just think about themselves. I'm going to have the most money. I'm going to make myself, more famous and stuff, so it's gonna go bad if you think like that.
Yeah, but then as a filmmaker, you could also think to mirror those people, to give them another end, to say if you do this, maybe the world gets a bit better or so.
Yeah, of course. But
that's not your type.
Ending, I think.
No, this was we wanted to end it because it's also shocking to shoot the main character in the last scene.
Definitely.
When I saw Psycho first time, they shot the main character in the middle of the film. I was like, "What the fuck just happened?" And it's also it was we wanted to shock in a way too. When we were writing, we were also we came to a point where we wrote how we expected it to be, because we've seen genre movies like this. And then we stopped ourselves and thought, okay, we have seen this. We need to push it further. We need to do the unexpected here instead. So, we want to, it's still, film is for audiences, and we want to, give them a ride.
Yeah. Yeah. With the scene in the house towards the end, when everybody gets shot and killed, and the tone of that was quite different from the rest of the movie. I felt it was almost I want to say, I'm not sure if the right word, but it felt almost slapstickish.
Yeah.
I also had some Tarantino kind of vibes. What were you aiming for there?
Yeah, I don't think violence is cool. So we could have done a cool shootout, you know, bang, bang, cut it. But I thought, you know, if violence happens, it happens suddenly, and it's probably pretty, you know, it's not so sexy. It felt realistic doing it that way.
Yeah. When it comes to inspirations, Alain, for this movie particularly, because you always, I think, when you write or whatever, you create something, you take these images with you from books, for a series. You already named some, but what were inspirations for this during this writing process?
I had a big, I loved The Duel, Steven Spielberg's first film.
Okay.
Have you seen it? It's a truck chasing a car. It's the only thing.
Okay.
You know, it's a cool guy driving a car, and then suddenly a truck comes up behind him and starts chasing him. And it's like, who is this? We never get to know the driver who's chasing him and stuff, but it's, and that's 90 minutes. That's the whole film. So I thought, holy shit, how can they pull off that, you know, for so long? And it's still
Yeah,
it's tense and buried as well. It's Ryan Reynolds in a coffin for 90 minutes. It's like, it's so cool.
Oh, yeah.
So I had we had The Duel as inspiration. We had, of course, Eden Lake, because it's the same type of genre somehow. And we wanted to play with that genre. And Deliverance, of course, too. The old movie, yeah. But I watch all kind of films. So I had my Hitchcock period. I had my Scorsese, Tarantino, Catherine Bigelow, Susan Beer, you know, I watch everything. So I just love films.
you take everything with you in the end, and it all ends up somehow,
I get inspired by everybody somehow.
You were already talking about, Sven, you wanted to, you have got a question?
Yeah, I think you also, this element that you, I think it was on purpose that you think that the hunters, the racist hunters are the people hunting the main characters. Was this element put in also in the script, or was it ended up later? Because now actually, well, the discussion worldwide about racism is really actual. Was that already the purpose in the beginning?
Yeah, it was the purpose, because, you know, I have brown hair. I grew up in Sweden, so I've been here. I've been called it's a code word, svartskalle, in Sweden. I don't know how you say it in your country, but, you know. It's been daily basis for me, so it's how the world looks ever since the 90s.
Especially when you go out the city, or is it everywhere you experience it?
Not in Stockholm so much. Here in central Stockholm, of course, because he has these people all over the world, from all over the world here, but it was much more when I was a kid, actually.
But at the same time, you didn't, because of course, as a viewer, you first think it's that typical racist guys so you want to tell something
done anything,
with that too.
Actually, they haven't exactly. In the end, they haven't done anything, and now they both are dead.
So
they died for nothing.
they were actually the ones who could save them.
At some
point, you're gonna, I started, they are actually maybe the guys that can help you. Especially you see it when Nadja is laying in the snow, I think. The other one, that the guy is laying in the snow and he's coming, how are you doing? And
Coming
from the back with the stone.
Yeah.
And there you saw in his face some friendliness, that he was really worried. He was really worried.
He was
there.
He
saw different eyes. That was a good way of acting, that you could say, okay, it's completely different.
Nice. Yeah.
But
Did you put, when Nadia finds out, when they walk out of the bar or hotel, and she sees that racist thing put on their car?
Yeah.
Did you put it on purpose to give a little bit of a hint of the twist already or not?
No. We put it there to frame the hunters.
It works for me well.
For me, but later, after you realize the story, after you finish, I thought, maybe I should have realized it then. You know, that's what I thought.
But is it also something then if you talk about that you had to deal with racism when you were younger, that you maybe wanted to tell also the message, it's not only the ones maybe, or maybe especially not the ones that you expected of, but also the people that you might least expected of that are racist.
Yeah, of course. And we play with people's expectations as well, you know. We see these hillbillies and we think one thing of them, but they're actually... Yeah. You know, they're pretty nice guys.
Yeah.
Yeah. Somehow, so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And well, if I summarize you a bit, you want to shock, you want to mislead people, you want to have plot turns, you want to, and this is all kind of a hidden mirror. I feel a bit you want to put to the viewer. Is that a way in your eyes that it's maybe more convenient, more effective than other movies who are maybe on more a happy ending kind of moral theme?
You know, I don't have I also like happy endings with more moral theme, but this story was supposed to end like this. It couldn't end it any way different. So, so for this story, this was like the ending. We couldn't change it. And Netflix also loved this ending, actually. I thought they were going for it, but they was like, you have to have this ending. That's the whole thing, you know.
And why are you are so certain about this ending that it has to be like this? Where does it come from? This
it was grounded? Just a feeling when we wrote it. This is like it's the biggest penalty. She didn't stand up for herself. She followed this guy, and this is now gonna be her death of her. And this guy is like. His biggest fear is losing the love of his life, you know. And now he loses her in a really brutal way, and he has to live with the consequences, with the guilt.
Hmm.
So
okay. But did you were saying like you didn't expect maybe to Netflix go for this, so you were surprised by it?
Yeah, actually. I was surprised that they went for it and they liked it.
Yeah. If I would judge from the outside, I would also think like, okay, maybe this is a bit too brutal, or they want to polish it a bit. But how was
is this film so brutal? Is it brutal?
Yeah.
Well, when it comes to the things like the dog, for example, there is some brutality in it, and it's not for people with a weak stomach, I think.
Yeah, maybe not, because there are more brutal films.
Oh, yeah.
Of course.
I think actually, besides the dog parts, I think it's not that brutal, no.
Well, the scene we just talked about with the belly and the boar.
Nothing happens there.
Yeah, nothing
happens. No, okay, but the imagination.
I know.
Yeah.
It's like Hitchcock, you know, when with the knife in the shower. You don't see it. You just see a knife and you just see blood. I mean, the imagination is always worse than what you actually see.
Yeah.
You were already talking in the beginning a bit about the filming process, how the circumstances also influenced your filming, and in the end also the script a bit. It looked horrible. Well, some images were beautiful, I have to say. You just want to be there. But some images were like, okay, I really don't want to be there. Did you also experience that during the filming? How did that influence the filming process?
Yeah, because, you know, we were filming at pretty hardcore places. We were at a glacier in Norway filming.
Okay.
And you can't control the weather, you know. You can control stuff, but the weather, you can't control it. And we were so lucky because we were shooting the parts when they you know, are coming up the mountains, the big shots where you see, you know. We needed to have sunlight there so we could see the view. And we had like 2 hours to shoot those scenes. And those 2 hours, they were like sunlight. And we're like, holy shit, what's happening? And then right after we said, thank you, now we're done, the fog came. And like, holy shit. And then the fog stayed for 3 days. But it was perfect for us because then we did the other scenes where we needed the fog.
So exactly. Yeah.
We had like some sort of sun god with us, weather god or something.
And the imagination. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And the scenes with the eyes were also shot literally on location?
No, actually, because we were supposed to shoot it on location. And we start shooting the film in March, February, March last year. But then the pandemic came and they shut us down. So we were waiting to start shooting again. But all the snow disappeared from from the north of Sweden. So when we were supposed to start again at the summer, we didn't have any snow. So then our DOP came up with this brilliant idea. He was like, okay, what if we just build a big white tent at a football field here in Sweden, here in Stockholm. So he built a super big white tent, and then we just digged a hole in the ground where the guy should fall, and then we just put snow and ice all over the place. And then we had like snow what do you call it, snow cannons in there, just making a snowstorm.
Cool.
Wow. So when if you go outside that tent, it's like super shiny summer, 30 degrees Celsius.
Everybody on the terrace, It looks, you fooled me. I really thought it was there.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, it looks good.
Yeah.
It looks very good. Well, yeah.
You need to give credits to the DOP. He's a genius.
You fooled everybody, I think. So nice.
Because how much part of that of the movie is shot there in the tent?
It's just the ice scene.
Okay, there's the ice scene.
The ice scene. Yeah, the other parts are is actually on the real location with snow, real snowstorms and real mountains.
And there was Norway.
Yeah, Norway. Yeah.
Well, but it was also unbearable conditions, guys.
Yeah, it was actually.
Yeah,
it was pretty tough.
So
we had like, we were at places cars couldn't get to, so people were walking like 45 minutes with headlights up a mountain just to shoot one scene, you know, one person running from here to there. But it's still, we're making films, so we have like a luxurious work, so maybe it's hard, but still we get paid to do films. We're doing our dream job, so there's nothing to complain about.
And for the actors, I think it's also good. They get more and more in their role when you are also have to do unbearable things yourself, I think.
Yeah, and the actors were the only ones who never were cold, because they had like this, what do you call it, understel, like this long johns, or what do you call it? But with electricity, with electricity in them, so they were like super warm.
Oh, I heard about those things. Nice.
They work.
Talking about the actors, that's something we also have to touch on, I think, because I think they were great in this movie and they had great chemistry also. Was it very clear for you during the casting process quite quickly that these are the ones?
Yeah. They just came in and they took over the room. So as soon as I saw them, it's like, okay, these are the ones.
Is it? Are there more projects coming from this crew and from you?
I hope so. Actually, I hope so. We are actually having. I have a couple of stuff going on, and I hope we get one of them going. Actually,
also written again.
Can you give us a little hint about that?
It could be a snake involved.
Okay.
Or if we go for the other one, there could be aliens involved.
Awesome.
Oh, wow, that's cool. Okay.
I go for the aliens.
I also go for the aliens.
I go for the snake. I go for the snake.
And we can expect subverting expectations again, I guess.
Yes.
Definitely. We always have on our channel, we do what to watch, some watch tips of what we think is worth watching. I'm interested to your inspiration. So if you would have to name three Swedish or Nordic movies that people should see, which ones would it be?
Okay, the first one is one of the best Swedish film ever. It's Cops. Cops. It's a comedy about a police station in a small village in Sweden, but there's no crime there, and they're gonna shut down the station because they don't do anything, so they start to make crimes themselves to look like
sounds good.
It's super good, you should watch it, it's super funny.
Nice.
Does it have to be Swedish or Nordic, or can it be
take what you want,
whatever I want. And then Buried, have you seen Buried?
It's with the person that has to stay under. She's the person is buried under the ground, right? In a coffin.
Have you seen it?
I think I saw it. Yeah, I think a long time ago. Yeah.
Yeah, it's super good. It's super good. It's just Ryan Reynolds in a coffin for 90 minutes.
Yeah, I saw it. Yeah.
It's really good. I like these high concept ideas. Like, okay, how are they gonna pull this off? But it worked pretty good. And then my favorite movie, Kung Fu Hustle, is one of my favorite movies ever.
Kung Fu
if you've seen it. Yeah, Stephen Chow. Haven't seen it?
You no, haven't no, seen
no.
it.
Okay. No, no. You're a shame now.
Seen it. Kung Fu Hustle, Once Upon a Time in the West is also a really good film.
Of course.
Yeah. Sergio Leone. Yeah. Rocky One, always the best.
I still haven't seen it. I'm very bad.
Rocky. You haven't seen it? Okay.
Rocky. No, no, no. It's very bad. I'm sorry.
International movie friends, you have to see Rocky One.
Of course, I know.
I keep telling him, I'm interested to hear your opinion on it. What about Rocky Four? Because that's my guilty pleasure.
I love Rocky Four.
Drago, if he dies, he dies.
If he dies, he dies.
Well, it's of course the Swedish guy involved.
Hey, Dolph Lundgren.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Have you ever seen Dutch movies?
I've seen Ocean's 12, but that's not a Dutch movie. It's only based in Amsterdam.
Yeah.
What could we recommend, guys, to when it comes to Dutch movies? Well, maybe some Dick Maas.
Dick Maas. Dick Maas. Dick Maas. I think you would like the lift, the elevator.
It's quite high concept.
Because I'm going to write it down here.
And another movie from him is Amsterdam.
Yeah. Oh, I've heard about that one. Amsterdam.
So the lift is about an elevator that is the antagonist on its own because the elevator kills people.
Wow.
So that's
is it quite a comedy or a horror film?
It's horror.
It's horror. Wow. From the 80s. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, I think you would like this film, the lift.
Yeah,
yeah,
I like it already.
But if you look at what's the greatest, generally seen as the greatest Dutch movie made, I think most people come up with the movie Turks Fruit from Paul Verhoeven, starring Rutger Hauer also.
Yeah,
Turkish Fruit.
And Romanian, what's a good Romanian movie?
I am myself in a Romanian movie that actually made the Bear in Berlin, I think is the prize.
Is that right?
Yeah, I'm an actor. I played with a band in a bar.
Okay.
I don't have any role. I'm just like a cameo somewhere in the back. Yeah. It's called Illegitime.
Okay.
It's a movie it's on HBO. I'm not sure if it's an HBO Nordic also. I'm not 100% sure. But yeah, all Romanian movies actually are famous for being very sad.
Yeah.
That's why I don't watch that many. But it's a movie about a brother and a sister that live in a small house. It has to do with incest. And
oh wow!
Yeah, it's a very very harsh movie, but it's it won several prizes, so it's very interesting to watch. I think. Yeah.
Nice. Okay.
Yeah. And we got from Romania now, of course, coming the documentary that's up for the Oscars. Is named for the Oscars for Best Foreign Language Movie. What was it, Koen?
You mean Collective?
Collective, yeah. Collective,
it's the true story of, it's also on HBO Nordic already. It's just the true story of what happened here, I think two years ago, there was a huge fire in a club here.
Okay.
After that, a lot of people died, very bad. Wow. And after that, it was for like weeks, people went on the street, like hundreds of thousands. Also, I went on the street because everybody wanted the government to step down, but mainly the local mayors, because it had to do that. I'm a musician normally, so we had a lot of problems after that because every building didn't oblige by the fire department rules. So there was like this club was officially they could have only entered 100 people maximum, and there were like 500 people there. Holy it went shit. Wrong with simple fireworks. It went wrong because they had foam on the walls. And the documentary is not mainly about tragedy itself. You do see it, and it's very interesting to watch. But it's mainly about the scandal that involves the medical system in this country.
Okay.
And, because most people actually didn't die there. They died after from bacteria, whatever, in the hospital. Oh. So it's a lot of corruption. It's a very interesting documentary, actually. Very,
I have to
hard.
See that one. Yeah.
Collective.
Collective, yes.
No.
So, good that we could exchange some recommendations.
Yeah, thank you.
Alain, it was great talking to you. It was great seeing this movie. Thank you for that. And thank you for taking the time talking to us.
Thank you for having me here.
Yes, we're going to keep a close eye on your work.
You're doing a great job with your channel. Keep up with that.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Appreciate
and we hope to see you sometime again when you got something exciting new going on.
Yeah, I hope I can shock you soon again.
Subvert expectations. Good.